Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.
Good evening. Welcome to Wheels Along the Road, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. I'm Kendra Cook, and I'm here tonight with Dan Olsen. And forgive me, I'm getting over some laryngitis, so I sound a little different this evening. I've got my tea with honey here, so hopefully I'll be okay. In any case, thank you for joining us this evening here at BCTV. Wheels Along the Road is brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. And if you would like to get in touch with us over there at the museum, we would love to hear from you. You can do that a number of ways, as you see on your screen. The museum is at 85 South Walnut Street in Boyertown, Pennsylvania. And you can send us an email, mail, M-A-I-L, at boyertownmuseum.org, or call us, 610-367-2090. Our website is www.boyertownmuseum.org. And if you visit our website, or especially if you're on Facebook, find us on Facebook. That's where you'll find the most up-to-date information about the museum. We're always posting videos, photos, little historical tidbits pretty much every day, so check us out on there. The museum's open 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. Monday through Saturdays, and we've got a great selection of Pennsylvania-built vehicles on display, everything from carriages and bicycles up to cars and trucks. And here at Wheels Along the Road, sometimes we talk about some of those pieces, and sometimes we go a little off the beaten path of Pennsylvania-built vehicles. So let's see where that leads us tonight. Dan, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Okay.
And I'm going to take a sip of tea.
Yeah, okay. I'm going to talk about a company here called Keystone Motor Truck Corporation from Oaks, Pennsylvania.
Well, which with a name like Keystone, I would hope they're in Pennsylvania.
Yeah, yeah.
So Oaks, not too far.
No. If you don't know where Oaks is, it's sort of in between Pottstown and Philadelphia, along 422, where all the movie theater is, and I think Pennsylvania Convention Center.
Mm-hmm. There's a lot of stuff in Oaks.
Yeah, a lot of stuff.
There's a lot of stuff.
Anyway, I'm going to be talking about that. But first, we're going to go back to its beginnings. There was a company called Commercial Car Unit Company out of Philadelphia. It was founded by a gentleman called Hilton W. Sofield. And we're going to find out more about him at the end. But anyway, he founded this, and I'm not quite sure when he founded this company, but I found out in 1917, I found some stuff, and they were making Truxton and Unitrux conversions. And if you could show the first picture, please, it's an advertisement for Truxton. And basically what that would do is take your automobile, your used old automobile, and they would extend the chassis, put a new axle on it, and make it into a truck. And that was quite popular back then. Again, this is 1917, and there's numerous companies that did that. This is a little different because it had a drive shaft. Most of the other ones would have a drive shaft to the original axle, but if you go to the original axle, at the end of it, instead of wheels, you would have a chain sprocket going further back to a new axle, okay, whereas this would just remove the old axle and have a dry shaft. But anyway, so that was the trucks. Then you can show the next advertisement, which is another one. You can see on the bottom kind of how they did that. Whoops.
There
you
go. Sorry about that.
There you go. Well, it's that laryngitis kicking in, right?
Even the computer has
something. Whoa, okay. So anyway, if you look at the bottom there, you can see and kind of a ghost figure of the original vehicle, and then darker is the extension, the new extended frame, and so on and so forth. So that's Truxton. Now, you go to the next one. This is the Unitrux, And this was, you can see right under the unit trucks headline there, it says unit for Ford trucks. So you could take your Ford truck and do that and make it in heavier duty so you could haul bigger loads and so on and so forth. And I'm thinking, is it the next advertisement? If you could show that also. Okay. I'm sorry. That above that picture, it shows the three models there. One of them is they extend the frame 50 inches. The next one extends to 62 inches. And the third model is 74 inches. So, you know, you could extend it quite a bit there. 74 inches is over 6 feet longer. And so it could be stronger and stuff. And I came across an advertisement. I don't have it here. Or do I? Hold on. I got so much stuff here. I'm so excited. Okay. The first, if you go back to the second one, please, and go back again. Okay, that one. It says one company bought 40 truckstons. And again, this is for the truckston where they convert an automobile into a truck. And I'm looking at that picture on the top there. And yeah, it's not a photograph, it's a drawing of some sort. But then if you start reading the text, it's talking about different companies such as Coca-Cola, New York Telephone Company, department store in Chicago, and a biscuit company somewhere. And they're buying these, and I'm thinking, why would a company such as Coca-Cola, and I think they were pretty well known back then, why would they be buying cars and converting them into trucks? I'm just throwing
like
that out.
Seems like an extra step.
Yeah.
Can you just buy a truck?
Yeah. You know, I don't know. Huh. I can see if you had an old car, mm-hmm. you know, back behind a barn and you wanted to make it a truck, you'd buy this and boom. But anyway, that was just an observation there.
Yes,
okay.
Strange.
So anyway, that's all 1917, 1918, somewhere in there. And then in 1919, the Commercial Car Company, which was also called Commercial Car Unit Company, I think that unit goes back to these frame extensions. But anyway, they introduced a truck called the Keystone Truck. And the factory, they built a new factory for it in 1919 near 16th and Glenwood, which is near Broad Street and a railroad in North Philly. Near Foreman Mills. I looked it up on Google Maps and said, oh, there's Foreman Mills. Okay. Anyway, that was the factory. The office was at 1714 North Broad Street. I looked that up, and guess what's there? Now, something's famous. You looked at my notes, you know what happened. Okay. It's Temple University's Leah Korth Center, which I thought was really neat. On the same location. It used to be an office building of some sort there. Okay. Later on, it was Penn Motors offices. We're going to be talking about Penn Motors later on, too. It gets really involved later on. But anyway, so they were based in North Philly, both their factory and office, and they were making Keystone trucks there. The first one that was built debuted at the Philadelphia Truck Show, which was considered the first real truck show in the city. So I don't know what they had before that. But it was in the Commercial Museum Building. So I had to look up Commercial Building Museum, or Commercial Museum Building. What is that? It sounds kind of odd, because I think of a museum not really having a truck show. But it eventually changed its name to the Museum of the Philadelphia Civic Center. So that's what it was. Okay, so it was a place that you would get educated. That's the museum part, but it was a, you know, an open exhibit area too. Now back in 1919, I saw two different models that they had, a Model 20, which is a 1-ton, and Model 40, which is a 2-ton. I couldn't find anything about the Model 20 1-ton, so I don't think they ever made it. That's just something I think. Okay, anyway, the Model 40 2-ton had a 226 cubic inch, 26 horsepower, four-cylinder model or four-cylinder Continental engine. I saw that, and I also saw that it had a North American Motors engine. Now, North America, Continental is like really well known. There's a lot of different motorized things out there. It doesn't even have to be vehicles, but Continental was a company that made engines. Okay, so you could get that. North American Motors engine was a small company. It was in Pottstown, Pennsylvania. It was eventually purchased or absorbed by Bethlehem Truck Company, located in Allentown. I don't know, they couldn't get that right, but that's
just to confuse us.
Yeah, so I thought that was kind of interesting. You know, here we go. It's a Philadelphia truck with a possible Pottstown engine in it. Three-speed transmission, a Russell internal gear rear axle, which also was on the Truxton and Unitrucks, they had the internal axle too. In other words, instead of axle, the wheel being connected to the axle itself, there was a small gear at the end of the axle, which drove a larger gear inside the wheel of the vehicle. So you could get a slower speed and better torque and all that stuff. But anyway, this company was building these Keystone trucks. There was really nothing spectacular about them. They were just regular trucks. They were considered assembled trucks where the company bought all the pieces and just kind of put together a truck and sold it. At the end of 1919, early 1920, I saw something, and I didn't write where I saw it, though, but I have a quote here. Keystone Corporation has taken over the assets of Commercial Car Unit, Philadelphia, and plans to manufacture a 1- and 2-ton truck. Now, basically what it was, I think it was just a name change, and, you know, for legality and stuff, it was a whole new corporation. The production manager was a gentleman called Orton C. Beecraft. Isn't that a great name?
That's a great name.
formerly general manager for Bethlehem Motors Corporation. That bought the North American Motor Company out of Pottstown, okay? The president of the company was a gentleman called Harry P. Harper, formerly owner of Harper Overland, distributor of Overland Automobiles. Okay, we're going to get into that in a moment, too. But first, in 1920, you can show the next picture. We're going to look not the next picture. That isn't either. There we go. Okay, there's the Keystone advertisement. And basically, all that little tiny writing there is just a bunch of statistics, you know, size and engine and springs and the oil it uses. It's incredible the detail they would go into with some of these advertisements.
Yeah.
And... But, you know, and I got some of that stuff listed here about the Russell internal gear-driven rear axle and three-speed transmission. One of the things it has on there, real tiny down on the bottom, is a couple prices. And it had the price for that truck you're looking at there is $2,100. It's $1,920. That's if you wanted solid tires. If you want pneumatic tires, it would cost you $2,350, so $250 more you got air in your tires, okay? So, and it was made popular by moderate prices. I guess if I was researching this properly, I would go find a whole bunch of other two-ton trucks and compare the
See,
prices.
See, that was really moderate?
But I didn't do that, I'm sorry. Sorry, folks. Okay. It had a Pierce governor on the engine, so top speed was 17.1 miles an hour. But you probably wouldn't want to drive any quicker than that. Equipment, front fenders, two oil lamps set flush in dash, one oil lamp in rear, a whistle, set of tools, power tire pump driven from transmission, and an impulse starter. I like the whistle thing.
Me too.
I guess instead of a horn, it had a whistle come, it operated off the exhaust somehow. Okay. Also in 1920, I found this, and I couldn't find a really good explanation, so you kind of had to speculate with this. Keystone also built a service truck for Overland 4 owners. Overland Ford was a regular car, and you know, the dealers would get this truck, I guess, from Keystone, Keystone built. And if there was a car that broke down or somebody needs service or something, they would send this truck, had all kinds of equipment and tools and so on and so forth. But it had a canopy top on the body with curtains and all-weather cab. It was a one-ton truck. Now, I figured they could have converted an Overland automobile with the Truxton unit and had the same thing, but nah, it didn't work that way. So anyway, so they were building these service trucks for Overland dealers. Okay, that was 1920. 1921, we're going to go back to Overland Harper, because remember I said the president was called Harry P. Harper, formerly owner of Harper Overland. Mm-hmm. This is 1921, but I'm going to bounce back to 1919. I have a quote here, and I saw this in some old magazine, newspaper, I don't know. It says, in Reading, okay, which is where we are right now, Overland Harper Company has taken over the Rajah Temple within a 500 block of Franklin Street and transformed it into the headquarters on the market of Overland and Willie's Night Motor Cars. So I thought that was kind of neat. And, you know, that doesn't exist now. I looked up where that was, and I forget what's there now. I think just regular buildings.
I'd have to map quest that.
But it's right in the middle of town where it was. I did have the address here. Oh, Franklin Street.
Franklin Street.
500 block, yeah. I think Franklin's like a block off of Penn Avenue. Anyway. So this is Overland Harper. Again, the Harper is Harry B. Harper, who was the distributor. And 1921, Willie's Overland eliminated the distributor from its plan of marketing. So now dealers worked with branch sales managers and stuff. And I have a quote here from another magazine, and it's dated October 8th, 1921, out of Philadelphia. Overland takes over Harper Holdings. And it says, in keeping with the policy of the Willie's Overland Company, Inc., to take over branches and distributing agency of all its dealers throughout the country, Harry P. Harper, president of the Overland Harper Company, this city, which is Philly, distributor of Willie's Overland and Willie's Night Cars for the last 4 years, today turned over his large holdings in this city to the factory. These holdings include the repair shops taking in an entire block, the retail showrooms in the company's branches in Atlantic City, Chester, Reading, Trenton, and Dover. There's that Reading in there. So this guy, Harry P. Harper, had quite a little empire going with the dealerships and branches, in eastern Pennsylvania, and talks about Atlantic City and Dover also. So pretty good. But again, he was the president at the same time of Keystone. That brings us to 1921. We have been in 21. Hilton W. Sofield, company's founder, left the company, which I thought was interesting because the company changed, but he must have just stayed along with it, and he still had something to do with it, or they wouldn't have made a big deal about him leaving the company. They still had the Model 40 two-ton truck. The Model 20 apparently was discontinued, but I don't think they ever sold any. They probably just, I don't know, had it for advertising purposes. The price for it went up. It was now $2,350 for solid tires, $2,550 for pneumatic tires. Then in 1922, I'm not even going to mention the price, but it went down. And they were still making the Truxton and Unitrux chassis. You could show the next picture also. There you go. There's a Keystone truck, and that's basically what you would buy. Not very exciting. You'd have your body. You would take that truck in 1921 and take it up to Boyertown and get a body put on.
There you go.
Or you take it to Beale Body Works here in Reading and get a body. Or Mifflinburg and get a body, maybe. Mm-hmm. I just bought some Mifflinburg body brochures, by the way. Oh, yeah.
Future show.
Well, I don't know. Oh. Maybe. Okay. Anyway, that was a free side thing. The price was reduced in 22. It was reduced again in 1923. Also, in 1923, we're going to visit back the good old Hilton W. Sofield. That's a good name, too.
They do. Okay. I got some good ones here.
He has a new company called Penn Motors Corporation. It purchased Keystone Lock, Stock, and Barrel. That's in 1923. Mm. We're going to talk about Hilton and his company. Hopefully I can get this right. I was scrambling around hoping it would make sense here. When he left in 1921, when he left Keystone, he retired for 9 months, and then he started this Penn Motors Corporation, which then, a year later, purchased Keystone. Anyway, when he retired, he planned to manufacture, or after he retired, or whatever. No, the Penn Motors Corporation, they were planning to manufacture the Hilton automobile. And their big deal was it could seat three people across. Other than that, it was just a regular car. But you look at the old cars, and they're quite narrow in the middle, so it was kind of a wide car. He also was going to build a truck, and there was no name to it. It was kind of interesting. He would build this truck, and if Kendra had a company, you know, the Kendra company, they would put the Kendra nameplate on the front and back instead of...
Ooh, it's like a vanity plate.
Yeah, well, instead Penn Motors truck, right. It would be the Kendra truck. Yeah. The museum.
Sold.
Museum Kendra truck.
Sold.
Not to be confused with the diner Kendra truck. Okay. Anyway, so that would be interesting. And that way, the people who owned it wouldn't have to answer to any dealers or anything. They were kind of independent. They would buy the truck. And I guess you think of it that way, then the factory building it wouldn't have any liability making sure that vehicle still worked. You know, so it has your name on it, not her name. I don't know what the deal, but they didn't make any. The factory for that was in Riverton, New Jersey, the only time we go out of the state of Pennsylvania today. But the offices were still in where the Leocor Center was, same place as Keystone was, which is interesting. 1921, Penn consolidated with Belmont Motor Company out of Lewiston, Pennsylvania, to make motor-driven cultivators and parts for agricultural service, which is interesting. Let's talk about Belmont. They formed in 1918. They bought, their formation was by buying the defunct Dial Company, which made cars here in Reading. Okay, yes. We got a Dial, one of four. We have one in the museum. Okay, so that was 1918. 1919, they built this Belmont company built a few leftover dials and then started building trucks. 1920, the factory burned down. 1921, it consolidated with Penn, again, to build motor-driven cultivators and parts for agricultural service. And the next year, 1922, a company bought Belmont and built fire engines, a company called Kearns Dewey Corporation out of Beavertown, Pennsylvania. We've talked about that on this show.
I was going to say, that sounds
familiar. We were looking at a Kearns automobile, which was actually from like 1909 or something like that.
Yeah,
okay. So that was 1922. 1928, this Kearns company actually closed down, and it's kind of the end of the story. It's kind of confusing because it starts in Philly back in 1917, building these frame extensions. 2 years later, they start building trucks. And they moved to Oaks, Pennsylvania. And then this Sofield, Hilton W. Sofield, buys the company and then merges with Belmont, who was building trucks and everything, and then they finally closed in 1928. So, I'm worn out.
What do we say? They're always like interrelated with five other companies.
And it was all Pennsylvania, except yeah. the one factory was in Riverton, New Jersey, but that burned down anyway, so don't count it. So, it was interesting. You know, I enjoy finding this stuff. It gets confusing, and hopefully I made it clear enough so you can understand. But, you know, there was even more stuff here, and I could have talked about things, and I figured, well, you know, I know Kendra wants to present something.
Always future shows.
We do. We do have some. Okay.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Now, you didn't leave Pennsylvania, but I'm leaving Pennsylvania.
Horrors.
Sorry.
That's okay.
And hold on here. I'm actually going to talk about this gentleman whose name I don't know if I'm even pronouncing correctly, but we're going to go back to the 1840s to start here.
Mm.
Yeah. So this is Governor General Lord Sydenham. Hmm. He was the first Governor General of Canada. So he was basically the administrative head of Canada over here. He was appointed by the Crown in England, and he reported back to the Crown. So this is, Canada's not their own nation yet. They're still a British colony. Now, this man here was apparently very concerned about the United States annexing Canada. And he wanted Canada to be economically strong so that the colonists wouldn't be swayed by the United States prosperity. And he really wanted good infrastructure and a booming economy. So supposedly, he is the one who brought the idea of plank roads to Canada. And it's an idea he himself got from Russia. He had seen them in Russia. And the first plank road in North America led out of Toronto. Now, this photo is much later than that would have been built. This is dated 1913, but it was the only plank road photo from Toronto that I could find. So this is about 70 years after these were starting to be built in Toronto. But
when is this again, that picture?
The photo is about 1913.
Okay. Because the road looks pretty good.
It does, actually. That's actually pretty amazing.
It's the space between the road and the houses looks pretty,
pretty dumpy.
That's a nice word.
But it was Canada that inspired Mr. George Geddes. And he took a trip to Canada in 1844. He was an engineer. He went there to look at these plank roads and to kind of study them for use in his home state of New York. And when he returned home, he started to work on the Salina Central Square Plank Road. And this was a 12-mile road, and it linked Syracuse with Salt Works. Hmm. Now, these are some illustrations of the Salt Works in Salina. Now, I believe he was also involved with engineering and designing and planning at this Salt Works. So this is, of course, very beneficial to him. If he could better hook up the salt works with like major transportation arteries. So he's interested in doing that. And he wants to better transport the salt.
Now, mm-hmm. What year are we on here now?
So this is about 1844.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm thinking, like, in the Syracuse area, you had the Mohawk Canal.
Yes.
Or the Erie Canal.
Yes, Erie Canal.
I'm sorry.
Yep.
It's the Mohawk River, Erie Canal.
Erie Canal was enormous. really. Yes. It was really mm-hmm. quite a feat in itself.
Yeah, but I'm thinking that might have been the transportation things you
yes.
were talking about.
Yes, I do believe you're correct. Erie Canal up there. That's a photo. Just so you can see all those horses and riders lined up pulling heavy wagonfuls of salt. The road was chartered on April 12th of 1844. And the directors, or the planners of this road, they celebrated its opening by riding over it in a stagecoach party. Which I think is kind of funny. This is an illustration of that road, and you can see this is what they're trying to, this problem they're trying to solve. You see the horses all the way to the left that are pulling a wagon in the mud. And I mean, there's still standing water there. It's really dirty and messy and very difficult for the horses. And you can see this plank road going down the middle of the photograph and that hay flat on it. Obviously, that looks a lot more preferable to what the mm-hmm. the wagon is trying to do next to it. Although you'll see it's one way, and that was a problem with most of these, is that they were one-way roads. It operated a lot like a turnpike. It collected tolls along the way. The Salinas Central Square Plank Road was completed, and tolls first collected on July 18th. 1846. So it took about 2 years from when it was chartered to when it was actually opened. And it was pretty heavily traveled. In one single day in February of 1847, there were tolls collected from 750 vehicles. That's quite a lot. Even that one photo with all the horses, mm-hmm. that alone is quite a few number. And that's a toll house. In New York, I don't know if it's this specific, Salinas Central Square Plank Road, but that is a toll house in New York. So the roads themselves, there's sort of a plan of how it would look, and you can see there's Syracuse. In the lower part of the map, Salinas right above it. I'm going to mention Liverpool here in another minute. but these are the routes that they're trying to connect. That's kind of a cross section of the road. So there, it's built on this wooden foundation of stringers, or sometimes they call them sleepers, but stringers is usually the term I see. So that's almost. You can see that's labeled there. They are firmly in the ground, those stringers. And then they use planks of hemlock or pine, ideally 3 to 4 inches thick. And they install those perpendicular to the stringers. And the road typically was embedded, so the planks are even with the earth. This does cause problems. Of course, here on the East Coast, we get lots of rain and snow and ice, so mud does get to be a problem. They start either kind of digging a trench sort of on both sides, or they'll elevate some of these roads slightly. This one's slightly elevated, as you can see, to sort of allow for that mud. And they use a massive amount of wood when they build these. Here's a section of road. This is from Syracuse to Liverpool. So that was earlier on the map. So in 1847, there was a call for sealed bids of lumber. And it was for the first 6 miles of the Syracuse and Tully Plank Road. It would require 1 million board feet of 4-inch thick, quote, good sound hemlock. So that's about 100 tractor trailer loads worth of lumber. So it's a lot of material. Mm-hmm. And New York really, really gets onto the plank road bandwagon here. From 1847 to 1853, New York builds more than 3,500 miles of wooden roads. Most of that is paid for by the residents of these areas. And a lot of these townships or towns are sort of in dire financial straits at this point. So this is almost like it's advertising to these people. If you invest in this, it'll revitalize your town, right? Because we're going to link you up to the canal and to the railroad networks. And railroads are still expensive right now. They're not quite as prevalent as they get later in the 1800s. So this is seen as a lot less inexpensive way. And they're also technically easier to build than a railroad. And as far as paving goes, for about a mile of plank road, it was about $1,900 to build. McAdam would have been about $3,500. Hmm. So that's way too expensive. But these start to get phased out by about 1865. Most companies start moving over to dirt or gravel. The wood doesn't last long. It goes about 4 or 5 years. Although, of course, they were advertising that it would be 8 to 12. But between those heavy loads, those heavy wagon wheels digging into them, all the horseshoes, that's a lot of beating up that they take. And plus, and like we were saying with the mud, all the water and the snow, that all deteriorates the wood a lot faster than they had thought. So New York obviously is one of the top states there, but New York, Pennsylvania, Ohio, and Michigan were the top plank road states. They had the most miles of plank roads. And do you know what the one thing those four states have in common?
What four states were they again?
New York, Pennsylvania, Ohio, and Michigan.
I don't know.
They are all in the top five states for lumber production.
Oh.
So for them, this was really easy, really. I mean, they had pretty much all the resources there. They didn't have to travel far with all the raw materials. Yet the other state in the top five is Maine, who I feel is probably a little out of the loop, probably, compared to these others.
They wouldn't have the trees, but they don't have any. They don't have a need for roads.
Right. They're not hooked up to the railroads and the canals quite as much. Excuse me. So just some of the more famous plank roads in the United States. Oops. There's a photo of one in Michigan. You know, I couldn't find a good Pennsylvania plank road photo. Couldn't find one. It's disappointing.
The nerve.
I agree. Dan, does this look familiar to you? Hackensack, Patterson, and Newark each had a plank road named after them.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I remember that. Yeah, I was a kid and I used
to... Well, you can read the bottom. This is...
Oh, I couldn't. Why? Well, I can't. I used to play hopscotch on that road.
these are major arteries in northern New Jersey, and these plank roads basically took them out to the Hudson River waterfront. I found this cool photo too from New Jersey. So there is still the Patterson Plank Road. It's still named that. You'll find a lot of roads named the Plank Road or Patterson Plank Road or whatever. And that's probably because it was at one point a plank road. So that's New Jersey. They had a couple there that were a big deal. U.S. Route 1 in Virginia follows the Boynton Plank Road from Petersburg south to North Carolina state line. So there was even a battle here at Petersburg, Virginia, the Battle of Boynton Plank Road in October of 1864. The Confederates won. That battle also has about five different names because every Civil War battle has like five different names depending on who you ask. Mm-hmm. But the Boynton Plank Road did have a battle. This is a soldier standing guard at the City Point supply base. You can see the plank road there. Canyon Road of Portland, Oregon was built between 1851 and 1856. That is a really rudimentary one. It doesn't even look that much better than the dirt road that was already there. You probably can't even really see it on your screen. The lines are really faint. So I don't know if it's covered in mud or dirt or it's just worn out. I don't know. I just thought that was a neat photo of him kind of pulled over. Flat tire. many, like I said, you'll see still today roads named the such and such plank road. That's because a lot of modern day roads just paved right over these. Fayetteville, North Carolina had one of the longest plank roads. It was built in 1849 and it went 129 miles to Winston-Salem. So this photo is actually from 1980 or so. They were building a mall or something. And before they built the mall, they did like an archaeological dig, you know, before they dug everything up and paved it over. And they found the log foundation of this plank road underneath.
About that.
That's a pretty neat photo. And then there's, that's Alaska. That's in one of the, don't ask me to pronounce it, one of the islands in Alaska. But you can see sometimes they get used for quite some time, because that is definitely not an 1840s wagon going over.
No.
So, before we end here, let's go out west. We're going to go to Imperial County, California. Now, this photo is taken in the 20s, but I'm going to go back to October of 1912. The Los Angeles Examiner newspaper sponsored a contest. They wanted to see what was the best route to get to Phoenix, Arizona from Southern California. And they figured that the people that entered and raced, and whoever made their way there first or the quickest, they would have gone by using the most efficient route. So there's a gentleman by the name of Ed Fletcher, and he was into building highways. That was his business. He saw this as a way to promote his own business, but also he was from San Diego, and he saw this as a way to promote San Diego as well. Most of the people in this race started from Los Angeles, including the Examiner reporters that were, you know, following this and writing the story. And the reporter even got a 24-hour head start. But this Ed Fletcher, he decided to leave from San Diego. And using a team of horses to pull his car across the Algodones, I am probably saying that wrong, sand dunes. Fletcher made, he won the race. He got to Phoenix first in 19 and a half hours. And he even got there before the Los Angeles Examiner reporter who left a day early. So he was able to get there going over these dunes, although he used horses to help him. So now he kind of had made a name for himself doing this. And he basically convinced San Diego, the businesses there and the government, the local government, to help him build a road made of wooden planks across those dunes. In February of 1915, 13,000 wooden planks were transported out to the dunes, and they began to build this road across the sand. It took 2 months, and in the end, they had two lanes of wooden roads, and it was about 6.5 miles across these dunes. However, the roads were actually too popular. I don't know why that's popular. It looks still pretty treacherous, but it was pretty popular. The traffic was almost constant. It's also really windy out there, and the dunes keep moving, which is probably kind of what's going on in this photo. It does not look safe. It looks like someone would not have built it that way. The planks just kept wearing down. Maintenance had trouble keeping up with repairs. And when they did have to replace it, they kind of, it was like prefab. They built it somewhere else, and then they had to pull them out there using horses. It was one of the few that was a two-way road, however, we talked about earlier. and it just, it was just too much upkeep, really. So in 1925, the California Highway Commission, they determined that, you know, the sand dunes aren't so bad if you can construct an actual paved road over them. They just, you know, they use their engineering skills, and they figured out a way around these dunes using pavement. So they started to build a new road, paved. They finished that in 1926. And then they, when they finished that, they stopped maintaining that plank road. So that was it for the plank road. Even the locals asked to keep it going, the Highway Commission said no. So there are still some sections of it that remain. There's a part out there with like a historical marker, tells you a little bit about the history. And finally, there are still some areas that use these today. This is Harrington Harbor in Quebec. And because the town is basically on a shore, that's a rocky shore, you know, not a beach, really. And really, ATVs are what they use to get around. This has the plank roads, and they still use them out there. So that's a little bit about our plank road history.
You know, when you said you were going to do plank roads, mm-hmm. I've heard of them out west on the dunes.
Mm-hmm.
And so it kind of surprised me, you know, the history, you know, going back to the mid-1800s and originating, well, not originating, but being used in New York and that. I always thought it was just something they did over the sand dunes because that was it.
I have to admit, I thought that too, that it was mostly a desert thing.
Mm-hmm.
But no, it actually, there's actually, they call it the plank road boom about 1844 or so to 1850 something. They were just building them like crazy out here. Hmm.
How about that?
Huh. It's crazy.
It's crazy.
Crazy. I know we're running short on time, but
we got about 5 minutes here.
Let's see.
We could throw pictures 1A and 1B. How's that?
All right.
Carco is dying. And I also want to tell the viewers, normally I would be packed and ready to go to Hershey tomorrow. But, there we go. I don't know for you viewers who haven't heard, but Hershey got postponed till November. And it's not even Hershey. It's going to be in Gettysburg. So, yeah. So I'm going through a Hershey withdrawal, sort of.
I love this.
So.
This is a great car, though.
Okay, this car, let's see.
But that's not a Hershey.
No, it isn't. I'm kind of looking where that is, and I don't know. I want to say Mukunji, but I'm not, I don't think I'm right there either. It's somewhere. This caller, this viewer is going to tell us where this is. Anyway, this car came with a red Ram V8. Red Ram V8. And it might have been Orton C. Beecraft's car. So,
I don't know.
Yeah, that had a Red Ram V8, which was 325 cubic inch. Okay, home viewer, what are we looking at there?
That would be a 1958 Dodge wagon. You can tell 58 because it's got the dual headlights.
Okay. Got dual taillights, too. But, okay, it wasn't just called a wagon, though. There was a special name for it. If you can answer this bonus question.
Oh, okay. That's a tough one. Okay. I'm going to venture a guess here and say that that was a Suburban.
Well, you got the first letter right. It's a Sierra.
Sierra. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
I think back then it seems like different wagons of different trim levels had different names. So, but you're right. It is a 58 Dodge.
You know, they did that just to confuse us now.
And confuse our viewer, which happens to be Joe.
I thought so. Hi, Joe.
Hi, Kendra. Hi, Dan.
Hi. Okay.
Excellent show tonight. Very good subject matter.
Joe, I have another question for you here. Where's that picture taken from? Do you recognize it?
That looks like Carlisle.
Yeah.
It's all by the row of porta potties in the background there.
Okay. Well, I was looking at the kind of paved roadway there, too.
And, yeah.
It's like a mixture, a mishmash of different kind of vehicles. So it's like at the corner of the car corral there.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like the gate was right where that house is. Okay. Okay. Yeah. So that's a 58 Dodge. Thank you for calling, Joe. And they made over 30,000 Dodge wagons that year, for those of you who are taking notes. There's a special high-performance Dodge. I assume even in the wagons that you could have a 361 V8, 361 cubic inch.
I think we do have another home viewer, too.
Oh, do we have another home viewer? I didn't see. Okay.
Hello. You still with us? You still with us, home viewer?
So, 58 Dodges, 12 of them, about 12, were made with Bendix fuel injection, which was kind of state-of-the-art back then. They had problems, so they were recalled, and the option was deleted. And I remember seeing a 58 DeSoto with fuel injection. I mean, that was like, wow. I mean, there was a crowd around it the whole time. So, and another option on this car was the Highway Hi-Fi, which we've talked about here. The record player.
Yes.
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 The record stuck. The record stuck. So.
You could fit a record player in that.
Yeah. a whole record console, you know.
Yeah. Have a dance party in the back of the thing.
Which also reminds me, I was in Walmart a couple weeks ago, and I saw they had a whole bunch of records for sale. So I know records are making a so-called comeback, but I saw them at Walmart, so I guess...
It's different.
Yeah.
I thought they only had record stores for those.
Well, they have to bring them back, too. So, okay, so I think we only have a couple minutes.
We do. We really don't have enough time to throw up your next one, but
which is like really cool.
Which is a shame. I know. I'm looking at it, and that's a shame.
They're always cool, though.
I'll have to save it for next time. Actually, I don't even think we're here next time.
I don't think so either.
No, I don't think we're back here till November.
Go out and vote.
So hopefully, my voice will be normal by then.
Yeah.
Gives me another month.
So yeah, it's election day next time our show. So
yeah. So
if you want to do a write-in vote, it's Kendra. I'm sorry.
Don't write me in.
So.
Yeah. So, man, that gives us another month.
So the museum, again, the museum's open still on Monday through Saturday,
yep.
Closed
mm-hmm.
Sunday,
mm-hmm.
9:30 to 4,
mm-hmm.
right?
That's
proper,
right.
You have to need the mask
yep.
and that kind of stuff.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Bring your mask. We do have masks there. If you forgot, we have, those
Halloween
one-time
masks. Disposed. That would be
That's
great.
A good idea, isn't it? Consider that.
Yeah. So.
And you know, I mentioned earlier to always check our website and our Facebook page for updates. And it reminds me, if you are on Facebook, tomorrow, if you're watching this live, tomorrow is Wednesday at 2 p.m. Autumn and I answer a question that was submitted by our adoring fans. No, people that are that go to our Facebook page and tune in. We ask people to send in questions and we'd answer them. So every week we answer a question. So like tomorrow will be our third week. So like the first week, someone asked, how do you decide what cars get in the collection? And last week, the question was, where do you get your ideas for exhibits? So things like that. So
that was me asking.
I hope that wasn't you, because you're one of the people that helps decide the exhibit. I think we have to re-explain Dan's job duties to him.
Yeah.
So if you have questions that you want answered, you have to send them into the museum, and hopefully you'll get them answered as
That's
we
good.
Go through. So with that, we'll miss you all next month,
mm-hmm.
but we'll take the time to make December extra awesome.
Yeah.
Extra cool.
I'm already working
groovy.
Next month's show, or yeah. December show.
It'll be groovy, we promise.
It'll be racing. Racing.
Racing. Then I won't do anything racing related. So, sounds good. All right, everyone. Thank you for joining us tonight. And take care. We'll see you all in December.
Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.